Well, welcome everybody to this Mission Blue webinar. We're super duper excited to have our awesome panelists here and also to have so many of you joining us from all over the place. I'm taking a look at the chat here. Plenty of Hawaiians, Philly, Montreal. Really, really cool. Cozumel, some beautiful diving down there, obviously. It's just amazing to see everybody joining from all over. So what I would love to do is if we could actually go around the horn here and introduce ourselves, that would be probably the best way to start this out. So I'm going to begin. I'm Brett Loveman. I direct the communications at Mission Blue, and I'm the host of this webinar. So I'm hopefully going to press all the right buttons and let the story shine through. So next, let's turn it over to Alex, and then Dr. Earle, and then Manolo.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alex Hearn. I am a professor at Universidad San Francisco de Quito in Quito, Ecuador. But we have a campus in the Galapagos Islands, and I've been working there for 20 years now. And really excited to share some of our findings with you today.
Welcome, Alex. Dr. Earle.
Sylvia Earle here, founder of Mission Blue and National Geographic Explorer at large. I, too, am just thrilled to share the view of one of my favorite places on the planet. I first had a chance to go there as a scientist in 1966 and have found it irresistible returning many times since, and with special reference to July of 2022.
Thank you so much, Dr. Earle. Manolo, buenos dias.
Hello, everyone. My name is Manuel Yepez. I'm from Galapagos Island and third generations. I come from fisherman families that's with the past of the year involved in tourism. And now since 8 years ago, I'm start working in conservation, meeting Alex Hearn and working now in different sectors for fishermen to show them that it's possible work together with be sustainable for the future of Galapagos for better healthy oceans.
Awesome. Welcome, Manolo. Good to see you again. Okay, fantastic. Thanks. So at the top of the show here, we thought we would share some slides that Dr. Hearn has put together. And then after that, we'll pivot to a presentation also that Sylvia Earle has put together for us. And let's start there. So Dr. Hearn, if you want to pull that up or I can pull it up for you, whatever works better.
So I share this with you because this is one of the most iconic images of the Galapagos Marine Reserve, and it was the starting point of our expedition. The expedition in 2022 was a great opportunity because this year, 2023, is the 25th anniversary of the Marine Reserve. So we wanted to take a look at where we've come over the last 25 years and where we still need to go to really achieve our objectives. And so we started off here at Darwin's Arch. And it was an emotional moment for me because the last time I was at the arch was the night before it collapsed. So I'd yet to see it in its current state of this repair. And I guess the thought we all had when we found out that it had collapsed is that, you know, these geological processes in Galapagos are inevitable and that they're part of the natural system. We can't do much about those, but we can take action to make sure that this portal to the undersea world remains the portal to an amazing amazing community. So some of the questions we had were looking at the whale shark, the largest fish in the sea. This is actually Manuel just behind me there, acting as a reference so that we could estimate the size of the animal. So we just wanted to see how we're doing in terms of tendencies of these animals. Up at Darwin's Arch is a known kind of stopover point. So we just wanted to keep a pulse on how many individuals we see per dive. We were also interested in some of the less known species of Galapagos. You know, people think of the Galapagos Marine Reserve. They think hammerhead sharks, whale sharks, marine iguanas, turtles. But this little guy here is very interesting. This is, we think, an endemic species of horned shark that's only found in the areas where the waters are cool. So it's kind of like a sentinel for climate change as well. So again, we wanted to build a baseline of abundance in terms of how many animals we see per dive that we can use to track these over time. So this is little Heterodontus koi, rather shy looking creature, not more than about a couple of feet long. We were also interested in this other little guy, the red-lipped batfish, which tends to be found in either very cold water or very deep water. And we would, again, not a lot is known about this fish in Galapagos, but it's an interesting fish for the dive community. So again, once we're down there setting up a baseline, and I can see Sylvia smiling there because she remembers that everyone saw this animal except for me, at least for the first half of the trip. And then the real meat of it for me was the slipper lobster. Again, this is an endemic species of lobster, which we have in Galapagos. And I'd studied this 20 years ago and provided a series of recommendations for its management because this is exploited. And it was very frustrating at the time because those management measures weren't implemented until 2015. So sometimes conservation management takes a while to transfer from science into action. Our concern now is that, you know, do we have that time to delay? And maybe we need to speed things up a little bit. So I was very concerned to see what the populations of slipper lobsters were doing 20 years after, despite the fact that we've got this exploitation going on. This isn't just an example of the amounts of lobsters that we'd pick out of the water. These images are from 20 years ago. So, you know, we'd go diving with those bags, a team of four people, and after about 40 minutes, we'd each come up. There you can see there's the bags from four of us. We'd each come up with bags full. So I was not expecting us to have this amount of lobsters, but I was hoping that we'd have something, but more on that later on. And then there was a lot of other objectives too. The beauty of this expedition was that it brought together a team of scientists from not just from Galapagos, but from across the world. So we had people studying the foraging behavior of flightless cormorants and penguins out west. Sylvia and Salome Buglas were searching for long lost species of macroalgae, of kelps. We were interested in finding out where and how much plastic is in the marine reserve. And unfortunately, as you all know, plastics are everywhere now. So again, it was a mixture of good news and bad news. I think I'll leave it with this slide because I think there's lots more interesting information to come.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Alex. Perfect. I would like to also invite now the wonderful Max Bello to turn on his camera and his microphone. Hey, Max.
Hey, hello.
Max,
sorry for being delayed, but actually talking with people here, a very interesting meeting that I'm trying to imagine in, you know, what would be the next few years. I think we have seen currently it is actually the model needed. No, I mean, Sylvia always talks about, you know, what is needed. And we need to think more about that. We kind of get cut in our own sort of like possibilities. And we're always thinking about what is possible. And so this little maybe, you know, and let's try to protect that. I think we need to start thinking about what is needed to maintain this life system that has been so precious to us. And when we think about that, we need to think in another different scale. You see animals, as Alex and the whole MigraMar have been showing us. Thankfully, we have that information and that people that is so passionate, so motivated to do things, no? And showing us how far the animals go, no? I remember Sandra Besudo putting in Colombia some satellite tags and of a whale shark, and that whale shark going all the way to Hawaii. You know, the ocean connects everyone, and I think looking at that and seeing the possibilities that the connectivity that is being proposed to be protected, and that we are actually, you know, moving forward in Ecuador, Panama, Colombia, and Costa Rica, it is extremely hopeful. I mean, I can't think of a better sort of example on the new generation of protection.
Max, could you describe about this time last year when the announcement was made in the Galapagos? And then I'll follow up with some images.
That sounds perfect. Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, we were, it was a precious moment to be with her deepness. And a matter of fact, the beautiful thing, you might have a picture of that, Sylvia, but you were the only person, civil society, sitting with presidents and former presidents and ministers and other officials that were representing. I mean, I can't think of anyone better to represent us as a whole community to someone like you that has been devoted to protection of the ocean. And we had an incredible festivity, but I also think, you know, that was just the tip of the iceberg. It was really, you know, about this reaching out to Costa Rica, reaching out to Panama to reach out to Colombia and all of that. That is changing the history of how we need to think conservation. And I can't think more of like Alex again and MigraMar and people like Manuel too. Manolo, which is a good friend and also has been doing an amazing job with the community. And everyone who's been involved, the government of Ecuador, all the governments of the region, but particularly to everyone who wants to be part of this, because I think now, as Sylvia says, I think the tipping points are transforming in turning points. We've seen it this weekend with the new ability that we're going to have to actually create rules in the high seas with the high seas agreement, and also with the new marine protected of Panama that got 54.33% protection. I mean, those are hopeful, amazing news that I think I want to take them and I want to believe and I want to continue working to actually continue. So yeah, Sylvia, I mean, like, we had a great time there in Galapagos, which is, I know, in your heart since you've been there from the 60s. And I also, I love it. I continue going and I love it even more every year, every time I go. And so if you have some pictures, that would be great to see it.
All right. That sounds like I should pull them up.
Okay. Actually, I don't have a picture of the big announcement that took place in January of 2022, but hope spots. The Galapagos, actually one of the logical first places designated as a hope spot. Now there are 150 plus around the world, a network of hope where we actually are engaging champions and communities to identify places that they know and love and are willing to commit to go from wherever they are to get to a better place. Being a hope spot doesn't really mean that it's fully protected yet, but it's a pathway to get to contribute to this growing ethic of caring. Presently, a bit more than 3% of the ocean is highly or fully protected, but we're on a roll with events that have been happening just within the past year and even the past week, where the need to protect places in the ocean at least as much as what has happened on the land. Well, only about 15% of the land is highly or fully protected, but with nations committing to at least 30% by 2030, you know, it's a long way to go from where we are now, but with the need to do so in connection with climate and biodiversity loss, I think there's real enthusiasm you know, my protected area is bigger than yours. It's like a competition. Who can be there sooner and make safeguard not just places that we know and love, but the whole planet that everyone should know and love. We can go to the next. Using a little submersible, the deep sea, as we did in July, made a world of difference. Next, please. Where from the inside out, you can go to see below the surface. And it's great to go down as divers, but being able to go inside a little sphere that is warm and dry, no decompression, even down to the maximum depth that the little sub can go, which is 500 meters. Next. So next, yeah, we were able to take Gustavo Manrique, who was the Minister of the Environment for the Galapagos, for Ecuador, and include his jurisdiction includes the Galapagos. He was just a little reluctant to take the plunge, but as you can see, once he was down there, we can go to the next image, please. Next little video. This Mola Mola came up and got his attention, whispered in his ear, said, "Protect the Galapagos," and then zoomed off. Next slide, please. We were blessed to be able to take scientists down into the depths below where they had been able to go before. Having individuals who are real champions, next, please, come along with us. The expressions on the faces of people as they descended really told the story. Next. Creatures who live below where light penetrates are different. I mean, they're the same general categories, but different species. Until fairly recently, you know, most of what was known about the Galapagos was extended about as deep as divers go. But starting in the 70s, when the Alvin actually went in the waters around Galapagos, it found hydrothermal vents and unique forms of life. And even here at depths of 100 to 200 meters, we were seeing extraordinary forms of life that you are not typically on the balance sheet when you think of why we should care about the Galapagos Islands. Next. Tui de Vroy, who's was in the images just before, was also born in the Galapagos, like Manuel, and has a unique perspective on the changes that have been taking place during her lifetime. I met her in the 70s when she was a little girl. She's become a world-renowned photographer and spokesperson for the wildlife in the Galapagos, but this was the first time she had been able to go deeper than she had been able to go as a diver. Next. Oh my goodness. When the lights attracted the zooplankton that gathered around and made just columns of life. Next, please. Indicating the next, please. There we go. It's just extraordinary. These are our little copepods and amphipods and other crustaceans that in turn feed on phytoplankton. Could we have the next, please? Phytoplankton, of course, drives the system. Little green guys that churn out oxygen, capture carbon, next, and feed zooplankton, which is a combination, a cross-section of life. The larval stage is like a nursery in a micro form that forms, again, the part of the food chain, the passage of carbon from one stage to the next. Next, please. One of the great things is to be a witness to this with the small fish, next, please, that are fed upon this is a little video at the Galapagos showing the penguins just having a ball, zooming around, capturing the small fish that in turn have fed on zooplankton, that in turn have munched on the phytoplankton. Next, please. And the turtles, also iconic creatures that you almost can't avoid encountering when you're in the Galapagos. Next, please. Oh, well, you can see them swimming around. It's encouraging that since turtles have been protected in recent times and the nests, turtles are having a comeback, certainly in the Galapagos, where, like all over the world, they were once taken, not so much in the Galapagos, although people did sometimes take tortoises and turtles as a source of food. But generally speaking, globally, turtles are respected for more than just dining purposes. Next, please. And of course, the whale sharks that love to consume the small things. Next, please. Getting into the middle of a food chain like that is a great experience, especially if you don't become a part of the food chain while you're watching it. This was in Cocos, one of the areas connected to the Galapagos, according to studies that the sharks travel along that whole corridor that now has been protected by the four countries that have come together to secure a passageway. Next, please. Along the offshore waters of the four countries, and now maybe through discussions we can extend, it will be extended over a much longer corridor along the coast of South America. So, as Alex mentioned, and as you heard from Brett in the beginning, part of my interest as a botanist was working with Salome Bouglas, who's a student at the University of British Columbia and also works at the Darwin Station, focusing on the deep water kelps. I was astonished when I first experienced being in the tropics. I mean, it's right on the equator, after all. Equator runs, cuts right across the Galapagos Islands. Warm water at the surface, but upwelling in places because two currents, the Cromwell coming from the west and the current that comes up along the coast of Chile from Antarctica bends toward the west and they converge at the Galapagos. So as a scuba diver, you can have your head in warm water right down to your toes and then your toes touch cold water from Antarctica in places where this layering occurs. And certainly the water is cool enough throughout the Galapagos if you get down, you know, even within diver depth, but especially if you get down a little deeper, 50 meters or so, you are in cool water where kelps thrive. I was taken by this lateral geographic representation with parrotfish, surgeonfish, corals, and the kinds of things you'd expect in sort of tropical or semi-tropical water, and like almost like a wall where the transition takes place, the thermocline, you find the cold water creatures. I mean, notably, kelp. It was one species was discovered in the 1930s that I encountered in the 60s and 70s and other expeditions, but I was with Salome in the fall of 2019 using this same little submarine. She had used a remotely operated vehicle and discovered what appeared to be a new species, and it's still not confirmed, but it, apparently there are two kinds of kelp. Next, please. And getting down in the midst of a forest of kelp in the Galapagos, it was just such an extraordinary experience. You expect this in the Arctic, in the Antarctic, on the cold waters of Chile, in the cold waters of California, elsewhere in the world, but finding it on the equator was just a wonderful surprise. Next, please. So Salome is now taking this on for her PhD topic at University of British Columbia up in Vancouver. Next, with frequent visits down to the Galapagos to try to get a grip on, are there two species? What is their range? What is their role? Who lives in these forests? So many questions, so few answers right now. And just a glimpse here of some of the species that occur associated with the deeper water below where the warm tropical waters penetrate. Next, please. And even deeper, you know, further you go, the more new discoveries you find. Next, please. Now, 6,000 meters down in the Galapagos, you see the volcanic action that is the basis of how these islands formed. Next, please. And issues. There's been news in recent years about the fishing fleets that gather right at the edge of the Galapagos exclusive economic zone. Commercial, industrial fleets fishing for, in this case, squid, but there are others that come for tuna and come right to the edge. It's the high seas. Owing to the declaration that just took place this past week, the high seas may now have a hope of protection, having large protected areas. It's perfectly legal right now for large industrial fleets to come to right to the edge of the marine reserve in the Galapagos. But that may change, and it's high time too, because industrial fishing, killing of wildlife on a massive scale, is having profound impacts on ocean chemistry, even on climate with respect to the carbon cycle. Next, please. Other issues relate to the next, there we go, the accumulation of plastics that is really new. When I first went to the Galapagos in the 1960s, no plastic at all gathering in the ocean. It was just beginning, the use of plastics for fishing nets and lines, now a major problem. Next, please. This little turtle, next, that we found in the Galapagos on a trip a few years ago was one of the lucky ones, because we were able to free this little turtle and give him a chance to survive. But many creatures, thousands, hundreds of thousands of turtles, birds, marine mammals die every year from entanglement, mostly with lost or discarded fishing gear, but other lost and discarded gear as well. So, next, please. I think what we came away from our expedition in July was, I think, feelings of hope combined with a sense of urgency. We could see the problems in a microcosm in the Galapagos, where 97% of the land is protected and maintained in a relatively intact state, only 3% available for human occupation. When the Galapagos National Park was established back in the 1960s, they kind of forgot about the ocean that was so big, people thought no need to protect the ocean. But we were celebrating the 25th anniversary of the reserve, which did not embrace 97% of the ocean, far from it. A relatively small portion of the Galapagos, even now, is highly or fully protected in terms of the ocean. But the attitudes are changing. And I'd love to hear Manuel's perspective on this as a young man growing up in the Galapagos, seeing how the impact, not of the local people consuming for their own use, but the large scale taking of lobsters, sea cucumbers, tunas, groupers, sharks, in a relatively short period of time, had a dramatic effect on the ocean wildlife. while the penguins and iguanas and other creatures of the Galapagos are highly or fully protected, but not so much the ocean. That's where I think this conversation should begin. Where do we go for the ocean to parallel the remarkable advances that have been made protecting the land?
Thank you so much, Dr. Earle. Manolo, would you like to describe a little bit about what you've seen change over time in the Galapagos and the good and the bad? Let's hear it all.
Yeah, it's really hard to tell you, but what I see since I'm being involved in the ocean, when I because I'm growing the island with different generations, is too big. Since when I was 6 years old, 10 years old, I remind with my dad catching in a few hours such many fish. But now I do the same, just go fishing for a few hours, nothing. The people in the Galapagos, first, we have two problems. We have a local fisherman, like artisanal fishing, that is not too big, but we have these boats, they came from all over the world outside of the marine reserve. This is one of the biggest problems affect to us as well inside of the Galapagos, who are local fishermen that we don't catch it too many likes outside. But the problem is in Galapagos, we like a local fishermen, we just all the time just we're thinking about just catching fish or lobster or sea cucumber, but we never learning how important they can be to the ocean, right? And then we don't think about what we can do to help to protect to them for the future. I'm like a fisherman, I can say my friends like stop fishing. It's not the idea. The idea is how we can help to protect and to be sustainable of fishermen for the future, right? How we can do that? Mm-hmm. How we can work with community, how we can work with the political side, with the science people, how we can work together to protect the ocean as well. And not just only for us, like a fisherman, it's for everybody around here. This is one of the biggest things. And another, how the national park, how the government can help to protect Galapagos. The marine reserve is really big. It's really difficult to protect. Even we have too many regulations in Galapagos, too many regulations in all the countries in Ecuador for boats, but still difficult. It's still difficult. And what I'm enjoying is start working with kids. I see this is the best way to start to do something with the kids. Since almost a few months ago, we're working with 200 kids, local kids from the school here. We're using a local fisherman to teach them for a few hours, kids, how important is protect the Galapagos. With different view, we show them how is working fishermen on the boat, and then show them regulations, show them what is marine reserve, what it represent to the marine reserve in Galapagos for us, for them, for the future, because we don't want to leave the moments like too many fishermen keep doing, just leave the moments, because they only thinking about make some money and understand to give you something for home. But we want to do more for them for the future. Don't thinking it just only in the moment. We want to try to give the chance to them thinking for the future.
Right.
And one thing I make by myself, it's a new system to help protect the marine reserve in Galapagos is fishing sustainable with traceability. It's a new system. I hope I give you the first step already. And this is my hope for the future new generation of fishermen in Galapagos. This is one of my main goals right now. I'm working like 2 years very hard, but some of the fishermen, they don't understand. But I have like already 4 or 5 of them. They give you a step with me. It is really important. Little things go to make a big change in the future.
Manuel, I share that goal with you. And I wonder if, in addition, we used to think of whales only as something valuable in terms of products, you know, or money. We used to think of turtles primarily as something to eat. We used to think of lobsters as delicious, or something that you could sell. I, in my experience, have come to see fish as creatures important for their own sake, not just something to catch and eat or catch and sell, just as people have come to respect birds as amazing creatures. I look at Alex's lobsters and I think of them as miracles. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. These are fascinating. I think of them as miracles, if you will. Where did you come from? Who are you? How do you spend your days and nights? If we can get children to think differently about wildlife, about those wonderful Galapagos iguanas and all of the creatures, the pelicans, the boobies, to respect them in ways that we should celebrate their existence along with our existence and see if we can make peace with them in ways that, instead of always thinking about them as something that we can catch and sell, there's another dimension. It doesn't mean we won't always catch lobsters to eat sometimes or fish, but we have a new way of looking at animals and kelp, the forests of the sea, as well as the forests on the land. So we have a lot of questions of people that maybe we should, we have a few minutes left. How long do you want, Brett, are you the
yeah, the show wraps in 15. Yeah, that's the current, we've got a lot going on. So let's talk. A quick question came through that I thought was interesting from Juliet. And she was asking, in terms of climate change impact on Galapagos, which of course crosses all boundaries, it seemed like she was more familiar with the climate change impact on shallow coral reefs, tropical coral reefs that, you know, might bleach. A place like Galapagos that, if I'm not mistaken, is deeper, rockier. What sort of climate change impacts are we seeing in a place like the Galapagos? And maybe Alex, do you have anything to add there?
So Galapagos is special. no surprises there. One of the main drivers of the climate in Galapagos is this deep current, the Cromwell current, that shoals as it moves across the Pacific and eventually comes to the surface or close to the surface near Galapagos. And that really generates a lot of the productivity in the islands. When you have El Nino events, that transfer of nutrients to the surface stops, and so the Galapagos system kind of shuts off, and then we have big problems right the way up the food chain. So actually, in terms of climate change trends, Galapagos has managed so far to be fairly resilient to that because that current is what's feeding the temperatures. Now what we are getting, though, is every so often you have an El Nino or a La Nina event, and that's when that conveyor belt from below kind of stops. The two strongest El Nino events, 1982 and 1998, were very damaging to the islands. I mean, we lost 90% of our corals and they've not recovered. For those of you who have been to Puerto Ayora in Galapagos and looked out over the bay at low tide, there's an immense area of rock that used to be seaweed. That all disappeared in the El Nino event and has never returned. So it's more a question of these El Nino events becoming more intensive and the system not being able to recover for them than a kind of overall climate change, thanks to this current. Now, if that current were to be diverted elsewhere or to stop, then we'd be in big trouble. But for the time being, we're okay pending these pulses of El Nino events.
Okay, thank you very much. I got another few questions here that maybe I would sort of summarize and direct towards Max here, who's our policy expert. There's been some big waves this past weekend as it relates to the high seas. There's been a lot of work being done in the Eastern Tropical Pacific in terms of tracking animals like MigraMar does, and also trying to sort of build this network of connectivity. I was wondering if you could just kind of set the table and talk about the whole area in a larger sense and what the efforts are trying to accomplish, and maybe how Galapagos is a part of that.
Yeah, correct. I mean, I think one of the things that is important to mention is that Latin America is definitely the leader on marine conservation to begin with. And I think that it's, you know, having people like Alex and also communities like the one that Manuel, you know, is part of, to are key to this element, but also people who vote and who actually are young people in particular, they are more and more worried about the future of humanity, their future. And I think they're engaging more in politics and deciding who to choose to actually do the right things. And so we have, for example, Brett, you know, in Chile, Chile when put the bar super high a few years ago with 43% of protection. Chile is the 10th biggest economic exclusive zone. What I'm saying is, you know, the exclusive zone goes to the 200 miles. And there is a very interesting story for people who doesn't know how that actually started. It was because of whaling, because whaling was such a huge commodity. You know, we were hunting wild animals to actually develop the economy that we now kind of have. And those animals were hunted to the point that some of these countries wanted to stop other countries to come close to their coast. And so they said, 200 miles is my exclusive zone, not to save their whales, but actually continue fishing, I mean, hunting them. I mean, sadly, that's the truth. But then things have changed, no? And Chile have changed in that regard. Chile was one of the few last hunting grounds of whales commercially, you know, until the 80s. And so to have the change to now being one of the leaders of conservation, it is huge. Not just the only the tropical Eastern Tropical Pacific that we've seen growing now in protection, but also just recently, last year, at the Summit of the Americas, Chile and other countries as well, and all the countries of the region signed a declaration for creating a corridor of protection from Patagonia to Alaska. I mean, that's the view that we need to kind of think of. We need to go further. We need to go beyond. And now we have the possibility of creating those marine protected areas in the high seas, which is critical element, as I mentioned before. We need also more in the coastal areas. Chile, for example, Ecuador, for example, too, needs a lot more protection in the coastline, where there's a huge diversity and many people are using it. And not because people are using it, we should not protect it. Exactly the opposite. We need to protect those places because people are depending on them too. And so we need to look at the things at the opposite side. And I think this region have done an incredible work. The last one was, you know, this 54.33% that now Panama holding the second largest in terms of proportion of their economic exclusive zone protection on Earth, but definitely the biggest in the whole region. And so we welcome all of these incredible things. We want everyone to get on board, and you can get on board in so many ways. You can call your authorities. You can vote for people who will do. You need to ask your candidate to say, like, what are you going to do for the ocean? I mean, that should be the basic thing. No, it's not just about the typical things that we've been voting for. It's about the health of the planet. It's about the health of our kids. It's the health of ourselves. We are under threat, and we're all under threat. And there are solutions. And marine protected areas, of course, they've been proved for 1,000 years. Polynesians have been using it. It's not a creation of, you know, a few years ago by scientists. No, they have been proved by communities itself, by indigenous groups, by many groups that actually, you know, they work. They can bring back ecosystems.
Could I comment as well, Brett? Here's the thing. We now have 8 billion people on the planet. When I came along, there were only 2 billion. When the Galapagos were first seen by humans in the 1500s, perhaps it was, maybe somebody got there earlier, but that's the first we know about. There are only 500 million people. What we could do in terms of our relationship with nature, whether it was using trees for fuel or cutting trees for other purposes, consuming wild animals for food, when there are 500 million people, as compared to what would be possible in the 1800s, when there are 1 billion people, or what we can do today with 8 billion people, about half of the land is now converted for agriculture, about half. And that's to grow things, to feed us, or to feed the animals that we consume, or to places for the cows, the chickens, the pigs, and other animals that we consume, just to feed 8 billion people. And then there's the ocean, where 97% of it roughly is open for taking, for human uses. About 3% is all that has been officially safeguarded. It's not working. We're seeing the effects on, and not just pollution, which is one whole category of action that is needed, but in terms of maintaining a habitable planet, enough greenery on the land and in the sea to continue generating oxygen and capturing carbon that has profound climate impacts. Follow the carbon. We're now hearing it's a good idea to plant trees because it captures and sequesters carbon. It has to be a good idea to keep carbon in the ocean in terms of whales, fish, squid, that hold the carbon in place instead of when we take it out, it puts carbon dioxide into the atmosphere just as it does when we burn fossil fuels or when we cut or burn trees on the land. We're just beginning to have the capacity to understand what we could not see and could not know, even when I was a child, when population was at 2 billion. So I think this is the best chance we will ever have. Looking at the Galapagos as a microcosm, as an example of success, when 97% of the land is protected, there are still problems with pollution, of plastic accumulation and other stuff that people gather. When I first went to the Galapagos, there were only 1,000 people. Now the residents, 30,000+ people. It's a 30 times increase of pressure on the land. And then several 100,000 visitors come every year, which puts pressure on the land and the sea, especially when it's not just feeding the local people with some ocean wildlife. Hundreds of thousands of people come saying, well, where's my local grouper? Where's my local lobster? It's beyond the ability of little Galapagos Islands to feed a large number of people on a continuous basis. And it's plus those that are taken from local waters and exported to China, to Japan, to North America, to South American consumers. So I think there's much to be learned by looking at the limits of what is sustainable within a small area like the Galapagos, and then look at the whole world and say, how can we possibly feed 8 billion people with ocean wildlife? In fact, all of the ocean wildlife together that it goes to market, we're talking, you know, millions of tons of wildlife extracted to feed distant markets, not just local communities. It's no wonder that sharks have declined by 90%, that tuna have declined by 90%, bluefins especially, but others as well. And in the Galapagos, you can see, and Alex can report with real authority, the fate of the lobsters. A few for local consumption and maybe to feed some visitors, but the scale of taking in the last few decades has simply not been sustainable. It's not been sustainable to take so many of the grouper, even the deep sea fish that are now taken for export. So I am really excited. I think there's great cause for hope. As never before, we know what the problems are. Imagine if we didn't know. We'd continue doing the same things we'd always been doing, consuming without thought for the consequences. But now we know. And I'm really excited about Manuel's concept of let's get to the kids. And now that we know what could not be known even when Manuel was a kid, let alone when I was a kid, we have the best chance we will ever have to embrace this little blue planet with respect and care so that we have an enduring future for whale sharks and lobsters and flightless cormorants and kids, all of us, that we'll ever have.
Brett, you're on mute.
Not making a lot of noise over here, am I? Thank you so much, Dr. Earle. Do any of the other panelists have any final comments you guys want to mention before we head off into the sunset here? Well, if not, okay.
Sure.
Yeah, Max, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I think, you know, one of the things for many people that feels powerless now, I think we have, you know, coming from a country like Chile, from South America, having the privilege to work currently with Sylvia Earle, having the privilege to work with Alex, with you, Brett, with Manuel, and with so many other people. I mean, it's just like, I couldn't even imagine to do that at a certain point of my life, you know? We have all the power. We have so much knowledge, as Sylvia said, in our hand. Those little things, no? We have so much information we can.
Did Max freeze?
He's just back from Antarctica, so he's probably.
I see. So straightening out the connection. Well, he had a good momentum there. All right. Well, we should probably conclude the show there. Thank you, everybody, so much for joining. Thank you so much to our panelists for making yourselves available. I know how busy you all are. We're incredibly excited about the strides that are being made in marine conservation. Even as Sylvia said, just this past week, it's a pretty exciting time in the space. And I just want to thank everybody for joining us today. There will be a recording of this webinar released on Mission Blue social media and on our website. And if there's any questions that folks have or want to get in touch, you can find us at info@missionblue.org. We'll be happy to hear from you.
Yes.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great afternoon. Great day.
Good to see you. Thanks so much.